Well, we're down to zero, so that means it's time to start. I want to welcome you this morning to the 11 o'clock service here at the College Church. What a beautiful morning to be able to get up and gather together with brothers and sisters who are here for the common purpose of worshiping our God. What a blessing it is to know that God has promised us that He's here with us, that our Savior is here with us, and that His Spirit will fill us as we worship. You know, a lot of times I know that especially as the semester goes by, it gets kind of mundane doing some things, and the repetition can become monotonous. I want to leave you with something maybe that maybe will help. I was traveling with my youngest daughter this past week to a track meet, and we were talking about what heaven would be like. And she goes, "Dad," she said, "you know, I know it's kind of cool and everything, but are we just going to sit around and sing forever?" And I said, "Well, I hope so. That'd be pretty fun." I said, "But I understood what she said." She said, "It's eternity. What do you do for eternity?" And I really couldn't give her a good answer. My only answer was, I said, when you can begin to grasp how lost we are and how great God is, maybe it can begin to make a little bit of sense about how blessed we are to be in His family and to be saved. And she kind of got that, I think, and I kind of get it, I think. And then last night we watched a basketball game, and it was my alma mater, Abilene Christian, was playing the University of Texas. And it's the impossible dream, right? The impossible dream. And I don't know how many of y'all watched that last night. We got three or four. You need to go back and watch the end of that game. It was incredible. David killed Goliath again. And there was no way this was going to happen. And after it was over, the basketball coach is looking up in the stands, kind of doing the Rocky thing, finding his wife and doing the heart, "I love you, I love you." And it was everybody was screaming and jumping around, and just, it was unbridled joy because the impossible had happened. And after, I was watching it with my daughter, and she's not a big basketball fan, but she humors me. She kind of got into it, and it was exciting, and she was jumping up and down and hollering and all that kind of deal, and it was fun. And we calmed down, and it was 11 o'clock at night, but I said, "That deserves some chocolate chip cookies and chocolate milk." And so we celebrated a little bit more, and I said, "You know, that was it. What you felt for those couple of minutes, that's heaven." She looked at me, and I said, "I know it's not basketball in heaven. Maybe not. Maybe there is. I don't know." I said, "But that feeling of the impossible has happened." So I hope today, as we worship, and not just today, but as we go on through our lives, that we are thankful and we're worshipful because God has made the impossible not just possible, but sure.
If you would, let's stand while we sing these first two songs. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. He came to live a perfect life. He came to be the living Word, our light. He came to die so we'd be reconciled. He came to rise to show His power and might. That's why we praise Him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer Him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King. 'cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything. He came to live, live in us again. He came to be our conquering King and friend. He came to heal and show the lost ones his love. He came to go, prepare a place for us. That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King. 'Cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything. Hallelujah. 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 That's why we praise him. That's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King. 'Cause he gave his everything. 'Cause he gave his everything. You can take a seat.
Okay, we'll be reading from Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. God's everlasting love. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Had it not been the Lord who was on our side, had it not been the Lord who was on our side, the anger of the enemy would have swallowed us alive. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side. Blessed be the Lord who would not give us up. Blessed be the Lord for his unfailing love. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the Lord. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side, had it not been the Lord who was on our side, the water would have engulfed us, we would have surely died. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side. Blessed be the Lord who would not give us up. Blessed be the Lord for his unfailing love. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the Lord.
Thank you for bringing us together this day, allowing us to hear your word and to praise you. We all come with our own struggles, with our own trials, and with our own problems. And we ask you, Lord, to give us the strength, to give us the knowledge that whatever comes our way, we can overcome it because of you, because of Jesus Christ. And we thank you, Lord, for bringing Jesus Christ and for allowing him to show us how to overcome. Because while he was on earth, he had to overcome his struggles. So help us draw on the power of Jesus through his word and overcome our own struggles so that we may rise and glorify you. Amen.
Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the lifter of my head. Thou art a shield about me. You're my glory. You're the lifter of my head.
You may have heard the story. Chipper the Parakeet never saw it coming. One moment things were great, he was singing, the next moment he was sucked in, washed up, and blown over. The story started when Chippy's owner decided to clean his cage. She's going to do it different than she ever had before, so she decided that Chippy could sit in the corner and she use a vacuum cleaner. And so she began the process of sucking up everything in the cage. Then all of a sudden the phone rang. She said hello, and then she heard the Chippy was gone. He got sucked in. The bird's owner quickly gasped, and she put the phone down and ran over and turned the vacuum off. She opened it up and found there was Chippy. He was still alive, but he was stunned. Since the bird was covered in dust, she immediately took him to the faucet and ran water over him, and then realized that that probably was doing more harm than good. So she thought, what can I do next to save this bird's life? So she grabbed the blow dryer and began to blow. She completely blew over the bird. He was shivering, and she wasn't so sure that she'd even saved his life. And what would he think now? Vacuum cleaner, water, and a blow dryer. It kind of went viral. Poor Chippy never knew what hit him. Sucked up, washed over, and blown away. But a few days later, after the trauma, a reporter came because it had gone viral on the story. She said, can you tell me, how is Chippy? The owner replied, well, Chippy just doesn't sing much anymore. He just sits and stares. The reason I bring that story up is I think that in our world right now, we feel like, hey, I've been singing in the corner, things are great. And then all of a sudden, we get sucked into something we never saw coming. And then maybe there's immediately water and then a blow dryer, and we wonder, how do I get through this? And our song is somewhat gone someplace else. We get to our text today, as Stone's going to talk about in a few minutes, the trials of Jesus. There's no question that we, too, have felt trials. In fact, even this week, there's been things that we've wondered, how can this be? This week, we've been challenged in particular by, is there racial violence against Asians in our society? And some of us know that around campus, some of our students that are from Asia or with Asian descent have felt that people have shouted things or yelled things at them because of the virus or maybe of long-standing things. It's the same kind of question we've asked over and over again recently. What about those that are dark, and what about those that are light? What about races that are different than us, that people can't see them as humans or don't see them as equals or don't see them as valuable? And the answer has always been from Jesus that every life is valuable, and it doesn't matter what your color is. It matters about our relationship. And so what's our response? Well, in some way, man has always been on trial and has struggled with what does it mean to really live for God, and what does it mean to treat people the way that we ought to be treated. We looked at last week in Mark chapter 14 about Jesus being brought before the Sanhedrin, is that the Sanhedrin couldn't understand because Jesus was against everything that they stood for, and their traditions could not allow them to see who Jesus really was. It's my prejudices too, and my preconceptions that often keep me from seeing who Jesus really is or who other people really are, and I miss it. James chapter 1 and verse 12 says, blessed is the one who perseveres under trials, because he has stood the test, and that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised on those who loved him. It's when we stand in the midst of that trials, we wonder, how will we come out of this? Maybe we feel like Chippy, and how we overcome. Yet we understand that man has always struggled. There was the trial in the garden, and man failed it. There's a trial with Noah's time, and man failed it. There's really a trial during the time of the judges, and man failed it. And on the story goes that man constantly cannot see that God should be in control and God should be the most important. And we often set ourselves up as the judge and the prosecutor and the jury, when God has always intended to be that. Luke says in a very similar text to what Stone's going to talk about today from Luke chapter 22 and verse 28. He says, "You are those who have stood by me in my trials. Blessed are you." It's when we stand in the midst of who God is, we understand that he's the one that has been there for us. That on our own, we can't do it, but he sees us as valuable, and he's willing to die for us because of the value that he's placed in it. Because a long time ago, God breathed life into you, and you're worth it. The trial is worth it. The death is worth it. The resurrection is worth it. Because God breathed his life in every single human being. And you are valuable. And he will go to trial for you. As Jesus walks on the scene in John chapter 1, as John the Baptist is baptizing people, he looks up and he sees Jesus. And it says this: "The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him, and he said, 'Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.'" You and I don't stand a chance on trial except through God. You and I often even wonder what our value is, but Jesus Christ said, "You are valuable enough to die for." And so today, when we take the bread, we realize that the bread signifies the body of Christ, who was perfect in every way, yet willing to die for us. He became the Lamb of God for us to take away our sins. In trial, we fail. But Jesus Christ says, "I will be the sacrificial lamb for you." And so as you take the bread with me, let us remember that Jesus sustains us. Jesus is our sacrifice, and Jesus says, "You are valuable." Let's pray together. God, we are grateful that you have stood in our place, that you have said that we are valuable, and you have created us and breathed life into us. And today, with this breath, as we take the bread that represents Jesus Christ's body, may we be reminded that you sustain us. May we be reminded that you are the sacrificial lamb for us, that you stood in the place and you said that we are valuable, and we are so grateful. So God, sustain us today and give us life and help us always to represent you. It's through Jesus we pray. Amen. Sucked in, washed away, blown over. You may be in one of those places today. You may feel sucked into something that you didn't expect. You may feel washed away. You may feel blown over. Jesus understands. He's been there, and he died for you. And because he died for you, he says, "You are valuable. You are my child, and I died for you." Let's pray as we take the cup. God, we are grateful that you have loved us so much, that you provided a sacrifice for us. Thank you for seeing us as your children and as valuable. And today, as we take this cup, may your blood wash over all of us and cleanse us. We find life in the blood that you have promised. And so even as we breathe, we know that you love us and care for us. And so in this blood that represents your blood for us and sacrifice, may we be renewed and reminded of the sacrifice for us and of our value in you. And it's through Jesus we pray. Amen. John 16:33, very familiar text for most of you. "I've told you these things so that you may have peace in this world. But in this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I have already overcome it." May you, in your place of being sucked in, washed up, or blown over, see the value that Jesus Christ has for you. There are a lot of ways in our church to give if you want to do that. Members of the church here give regularly. One of the things that we've added recently, we have online giving. That's changed a little bit. There are boxes that you're welcome to do that. Of course, bring it by the office. But one of the things that I said, hey, if I work with college students, we need text to give. And so now there's texting to give. You can actually do that. The first time you do it, it kind of makes you set something up. But we've actually now, we're in the 2000s. And so I want you to know that if you want to give that way, you're welcome to do that. Here's the thing is, God calls us to be managers of our resources. Money is one way. If you're a college student, you may think, I don't have any. But God says, would you give back to me? And so whether it's through money or through your time or whatever, God says, be my manager. Pray with me. God, we are grateful that you have loved us, and thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for the way that you have walked with us through our trials. And for some of us right now, would you speak life into us, because we're not so sure we're going to get through the one that we're in. But God, help us always to be managers of the things that you've given us, to be good stewards. And so through, as we offer our bodies up to you, whether it's our time, our resources, or our money, may we always be willing to give back to you. Thank you for loving us. And would you please accept our gifts of whatever we have to give, is coming from our heart. And just thank you for today. And it's through Jesus we pray. Amen.
If you would stand for the song before the lesson this morning. What we're going to talk about this morning is trials. And that's a message and the theme for today. And I know my job is to sing up here, but it made me think about the book of Ecclesiastes and the message that the writer of Ecclesiastes has for his readers, which pretty much is that everything is futile, everything is vanity. The good things like wisdom, work, and pleasure, and wealth, all in the end, don't really matter. In the first chapter, he says, "What does man gain by all the toil at which he toils under the sun? A generation goes and a generation comes, but the earth remains forever. There is no remembrance for former things, nor will there be any remembrance of later things yet to be among those who come after." And that's kind of a sad message, not a super happy message to hear, but towards the end, after he talks about everything he goes through in the book, the final verses, verses 13 and 14 of chapter 12, he says, "The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil." And we know that if we fear God and keep his commandments, we have a reward after this life. And that's obviously heaven, and we're about to sing about heaven. So I thought I would just share that with you before to prepare your minds for the lesson and for singing this song, that even though we face so many horrible things in this life, and we experience so many amazing things in this life, the end of the matter is to keep God's commandments and to work towards the goal that we have in heaven. So, "This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know he'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land, we'll live eternally.
The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drift back from heaven's shore. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
You can take a seat.
Mark chapter 15, the stage is set for Pilate to enter, and upon his entrance, he says, "Who will you have me release to you? Barabbas, a murderer during the insurrection against Rome, convicted to be sent to death? Or this Jesus, your Messiah, King of the Jews?" And so, we have to ask, who is on trial? Jesus or us? Who's got a decision to make, Jesus or us? Something that I think is a theme throughout Mark, but also throughout these chapters in Mark, is that burning question, who is Jesus? And finally, in chapter 14, in the latter portion, towards the end, and also in chapter 15, when Pilate's questioning Jesus, we finally get that answer, where Jesus says, "I am the Son of God. I am the King of the Jews," or at least implies such. So who is Jesus? Is he a poet turned radical politician trying to start a revolution? Is he a preacher who's on a mission? He talks about fishing in some new kind of kingdom. Is he just a small town wannabe that's tired of doing carpentry with his father, trying to carve out a little fame for himself? Is he John, Elijah? Is he a teacher, or is he a Messiah? Or could the one that we know as Mary's son be the long-awaited Holy One? You know, 2,000 years and counting, that question is still mounting, and the answer is still just a mustard seed. That's what's on trial here. It's a mustard seed of faith. Science isn't going to be able to prove it, and critics will continue to accuse it as being a crutch for the weak. The leper who leaps and the blind man who sees, I'll say they're just nice fairy tales. Fact or fiction, we could just be wishing on pennies down in a well. But while we're weary in our trials, wrestling with the truth, could it really be that the truth is reaching out to you? Immediately following the Jews' illegal court held in the middle of the night, after taking Jesus out of the garden, they try to get their story straight. And we went over this in John 14 last week. They're trying to get their story straight. And the writer of Mark says that their stories didn't match up. They're throwing accusations at Jesus, saying, "Well, he says that he's the Son of God. He says that he's going to destroy the temple." But their stories don't match up. Wild accusations. And finally, someone asks Jesus, "Who do you say that you are? Are you the Son of God?" And Jesus says, "I am, and you will see me sitting at the right hand of power." And that's all that they needed. He says he's the Son of God. He's in competition with Rome, and he blasphemes against our God. That's all that we need. So they bind him, just as Psalm 118 and 27 says that they bind the sacrifice to be tied to the horns of the altar. They bind this Jesus and take him to the horns of the altar to be judged by Pilate, because the Jews can't condemn someone to death, not by law. So they're going to go about it another way. We'll have him tried by Rome. And they know that they have to do this in the middle of the night, and early in the morning they've got to take him over to Pilate because they're running out of time. Because, as the scriptures say, this is the day that it is custom for Pilate to release to them one of the prisoners. And it just happens that the other prisoner to be released is Barabbas. Turn to Mark chapter 15 and let's go ahead and read the text, and we'll see what exactly is going on here. "And as soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. And they bound Jesus and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate. And Pilate asked him, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' And he answered him, 'You've said so.' And the chief priests accused him of many things. And Pilate again asked him, 'Have you no answer to make? Do you not see how many charges they bring against you?' But Jesus made no further answer, so that Pilate, he was amazed. Now at the feast, he used to release for them one prisoner for whom they asked. And among the rebels in prison who had committed murder in the insurrection, there was a man called Barabbas. And the crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do as they usually do for them. And he answered them, saying, 'Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?' For he perceived that it was out of envy that the chief priests had delivered him up. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd." And the idea behind this is they stirred up the crowd by prodding them along with evil intent to have him release for them Barabbas instead. And Pilate again said to them, "Then what shall I do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" Notice that we have Barabbas the insurrectionist and Jesus the king. They're both being tried for the same thing here. Insurrection, perdition against Rome. Barabbas, the leader of the insurrection, and Jesus, the prop-up king. Pilate said, "What do I do with this man you call the king of the Jews?" And they cried out again, "Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done?" They shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, Matthew will say, fearing a revolt, and as well his wife having a vision the night before and saying, "This man has been tormenting me all night." Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas. And having scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. Now, it might be interesting to note that scourging wasn't necessarily common pre-crucifixion, because oftentimes you're running a high chance of dying in the scourging. A cord with at least three, tied off whips at the end of a long whip that's going to have bone and metal and rock and all kinds of other things tied into it to rip flesh from the body. The blood loss is going to be enormous. It's generally a tactic of punishment, not a precursor to the worst torture punishment that there is. So it seems Pilate is maybe saying, "Okay, go flog him, and then maybe the people will have eased, seeing that he's been, duly punished,
and we can avoid this whole crucifixion thing, but no, 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 no. They're dead set on crucifixion. Death. Priests were arguing against what accusation would stick. But Jesus confessing that he was the Son of God, that he was the King of the Jews, was the last straw. But we'll see that Jesus doesn't defend himself against the other accusations, which one could assume are baseless accusations that are such the kind that they had argued about the night before. And Pilate's amazed by this. Why? His contempt for death. It stares him in the face, and yet he does not speak a word against it. He has already accepted the cup that God has given him. His Father has told him, "You will drink this cup," and Christ said, "Yes, I will drink it." So, he finally confesses after all this time in the Gospels wondering who is Jesus. The disciples have asked him over and over again, and he gives them these shady answers. People have come up to him and said, demons have come up to him and said, "You're the Son of God, I know you." And he says, "Shut up!" But finally, Jesus says, "Yes, I am. But now..." Just a few days after the people, Jesus riding in on a donkey, walking on the palm leaves, after they've said, "Hosanna, Hosanna, King David has returned to the city of Jerusalem." Just a few days later, they're saying, "Not my Messiah. This is not my king. This is not the kind of Messiah I was looking for. This is not the kind of king that I wanted. He is not made in my image." Crucify him. So, you're a cynic, but I get it. It's hard to trust what you can't see. You've been broken, and how can you hope in or believe in a mystery? You've got to know where you stand when Jesus asks, "Who do you say that I am?" Pilate's confronted with that question. And we, in the crowd, along with the other Jews, are confronted with that question. Who is this guy? Who does he say that he is? Is he who he claims to be? We're like him in so many ways. I have been. Say, not this Jesus. It's not my Jesus. My God isn't like that. Not the Jesus that I know. Because deep down, we know that if we call Jesus our King, we know if we hold that claim to be true, that this man is King, this man is Messiah, that instead of bowing down to ourself, instead of bowing down to our version of self-betterment, our version of self-love, our version of peace, instead of bowing down to our political identity, that we will have to bow down to Jesus. And that's just a price that I'm not sure that we know whether or not we can pay. The Jews, the priests at least, know this to be the case, and they can't give it up. Sometimes we often find it hard to let the Spirit work in us because we like things how they are. We like the control that we seem to think that we have. We don't want a kind of king that isn't made in our image. That we are made in his. Though we struggle to reflect it. The gospel is not about self-improvement or behavioral change. The gospel is about Jesus being the only way this world makes sense. And the only way that there is any hope beyond our death. It's about the hope of the resurrection, the redemption of all creation. And you say, how can one man be worth that? This one man is worth more than all men put together. He is God in flesh, come down, and when he is put on trial, we ourselves are put on trial as well, because we say this is not the Messiah that we want. And we repeat this over and over and over. But although it's hard to believe, which is harder? That a loving and powerful God created everything for his glory and created us to live in that glory with himself. And that he would be the sacrifice that reunites us to that. Or that it's by chance, that there's no purpose in life, there's no ultimate meaning, there's no anything. If that's the case, we can forget our politics, our sense of morality, our sense of indignation at things that put off to us. Because the philosophy of chance with no actual purpose to existence leads you to believing nothing at all. You can make a stance in some place or believe that something to be true, but you have nothing to be able to support it with. We can say this, Jesus isn't my king, but we aren't understanding the implications of what it means for us to say, not Jesus. It means that if he is the only way, the truth, and the life, that without him, there's no hope. Without him, our sense of identity, our sense of morality, our sense of being able to have control over the situation, that we can be right about things or that we can be wrong, is gone. We ought to just quit getting offended about things if that's the case. But this Jesus is the Son of God. He is the Messiah. And Pilate feels uneasy about it. If you go back and read Matthew, he goes and washes his hands and says, this man's blood is not on my hands, it's on yours. It's on ours. It's on mine. In Mark 15:2, Jesus confesses his lordship. 15:4-5, Pilate's amazed that he's not answering all of these accusations against him. 15:9, don't kill the insurrectionist, kill the king. They will turn the Davidic king over to the foreign nation to be taken into captivity and to be killed. And he will be the last Davidic king to ever grace the steps of the temple in Jerusalem. But he's also the only Davidic king that we need. Now, following this, the false confessors come forward, and there's this whole theme in these three chapters of Mark of people either denying Jesus, confessing Jesus, who don't actually believe in Jesus, or those who just flat out reject Jesus. But it all began with those who praised Jesus for who they thought he was, and then instantly turn around and say, nope, nope, nope. I was wrong, not this guy. Not what I thought I was getting into. They spit on him, which if you're a Jew or if you're just, a normal human being, that's nasty. But also, it makes you unclean. Spit on you, hit you, the priest, put a bag over his head before all this happened, so I'm sure he's got black eyes and such by now, and punched him and said, prophesy! Punched him again, prophesy! Where's it coming from? And Jesus takes it. And now, crown of thorns is stuck into his head, a purple robe is put around him, and as if to fulfill the prophecy Jesus spoke himself, although they didn't know they would have to fulfill it twice, they bow down and say, Hail, King of the Jews. Little do they know that there will come a day when they will again bow before Jesus and say, "Hail, Lord of lords and King of kings," but they'll mean it this time. We'll start to wrap it up here. So we have a question, and I think that it's the main question of chapter 15. Besides trying to illustrate, you know, what he goes through, the kangaroo courts that he bounces from, Mark moves pretty fast. He leaves some of the gore out to give us just the gist of here's what's going on. But I think this is the main question in Mark 15. So who is Jesus? He leaves us with a question to ask ourselves that we have to answer. You can't leave here without answering this question for yourself. Who is Jesus? If he truly is who he says that he is, then it is absolutely transformational for what the rest of your life looks like. You can't leave this building having answered that question yes and look the same. And I'm not saying that that means that you go and you say, "Well, I got to do better. I'm going to pull myself up by my bootstraps and I'm going to do everything right from now on," because you're not. You're going to fail. And that's okay. It means that you leave this building knowing that there is a Savior, knowing that there is grace available for you and to you. It means that you leave this building knowing that there is a purpose to your existence, knowing that there is a purpose for those who are around you, for those that you see every day, that there's a purpose to the struggle, that it doesn't all just mean nothing, and that there is peace in knowing that this same Jesus, who was beaten, who was mocked, who was blasphemed, who was nailed, and who was resurrected, is the one in whom there is ultimate hope, and the one in whom his blood is going to cover you and has covered you already and is sufficient to cover every mistake, every sin, every wrong, every fault, and restore you to God. Because there's coming a day when all of this struggle, and you know, we say, we complain about, you know, how bad the world's getting, how bad it's getting, man, it's just so rough. And I don't wish for the world to continue down that path, I don't, I promise, so don't hear this as that. But, and this is not my quote, if I could remember who said it, I would tell you, because this is too clever for me. The worse and worse the world gets, the more catastrophic it looks, the more glorious it is. Because we know that there is a glorious time awaiting after the struggle for those who persevere. And I don't mean for those who tried hard enough to get through it. I mean for those who have persevered because of the Spirit of God. For those who have been sealed with the promise. God is not slack concerning his promises. He'll keep them. We can bank on that. We have a promise that Jesus is who he says he is. He's worthy of our allegiance and our worship as King. Not just of Israel, but King over all creation, over the entire cosmos. With a word. He is that word that was spoken. Let there be light. He is that word, that divine word that punches through all of creation and makes things be. He's worthy of our worship. How long will we wait? How long will we place ourselves on trial in deciding who this Jesus is? Because it's not our judgment to be cast on him. He is who he is, and he will be who he will be. Forever and ever, as he has been, will he forever be. Our judgment upon him does not change the reality that Jesus is the Messiah. But our decision on the vote that we cast towards Jesus is a judgment upon our own head. There's too much hope in Jesus to just give up on Jesus. We have to realize that a good heart doesn't pump the same flow of blood that Jesus' heart did on that cross. A good heart's not going to save us. Jesus is, though. Will we send Jesus to death, or will we die to ourselves? And that's a hard decision. I'm not telling you that it's not. It's not an easy road. It's the road that's worth it, though. And it's worth it because of Christ and because of who He is. Not because of who we are, not because of what we think, what we believe, who we agree with, who we voted for. It's all because of Christ. So, I challenge you, as you sit here and before we leave today, maybe you don't have to decide this minute, but there's a decision to be made, and this life is going to keep on rolling. It's not going to stop for anybody. We've got to decide, is Jesus who He says He is? And if yes, that has great benefits and great blessings and great trials ahead, but with Christ, all things are going to work together for the good of those who love Him.
If you would stand again for me. Thank you, Stone, for that message. There's a popular Devo song that goes, "Can you still feel the nails? Can you still hear the crowd cry, 'Crucify'? Are we hurting Him every time we sin?" I think there's something to be said about that image, but I don't think He does feel the nails anymore, because He's a perfect King and the perfect High Priest, and Hebrews tells us that if He wasn't an eternal perfect High Priest, that He would have to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the earth, but He's appeared once and for all at the end of the age. So Jesus has offered a sacrifice once and for all, and He doesn't hurt anymore physically. And He wants us all to come to Him. So thank you again, Stone, for that. And of course, if you need anything, prayers, or to be baptized for the remission of your sins and have hope for eternal life with Jesus Christ in heaven, you can come forward while we sing this song. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
You can be seated.
Thank you, Stone, for that lesson. The answer to that question, who is Jesus, makes all the difference in the world and in the world to come. Because for us, He is our Savior. And whatever happens in this life ultimately doesn't matter, because we know that we have a home waiting for us. I'm going to lead a closing prayer. It's what I've led at the elders' meeting this last Wednesday night. Not to go all political on anybody or anything, but Congress is considering several bills right now that would force Christians to violate their consciences could even force Christian colleges to hire people and admit students who are engaged in sexual behavior that is clearly unbiblical. It could even legally affect how the church conducts its activities. The most significant of these bills is the so-called Equality Act. It would elevate to the same level as our skin color, our race, or our gender, things like same-gender sexual behavior, gender identity and behavior associated with that, transgender activity, and perhaps most significantly, it would remove several protections for religious organizations who can make decisions based on those types of things right now. And so this prayer I'm going to lead is directly related to that. So if we would close with that prayer, let's do that. Dear Father, we come before you humbly, you, the all-knowing, all-powerful God. In your great wisdom and knowledge, you make things happen, you allow them to happen, or you stop them from happening. Through that wisdom and knowledge, you have given Christians in this country unparalleled freedom. For 200 plus years, we've been able to pursue you, praise you, and proclaim you without fear. We ask for that freedom to continue through this generation and the generations to come. We pray that you give us government leaders who value that freedom. We pray that you give our leaders godly wisdom, even if they don't know that's what it is. When their efforts are consistent with your will, we ask that you bless their efforts and that you thwart their efforts that are not consistent with your will. We ask that you defeat any bill that would force the church or individual Christians to violate their consciences. We ask that you defeat any bill that would embolden the culture that disregards and disdains your word. We ask that you defeat any bill that would protect and put on a pedestal behavior that you abhor. And we ask for revival, for hearts that turn toward you. But whatever happens, may our faith never waver. In all circumstances, may we boldly declare the gospel. If the forces of persecution rise up against your church, may we boldly declare the gospel. If Satan gains a greater foothold in our culture, may we boldly declare the gospel. And if sin crouches at our door, may we boldly declare the gospel. And when it comes to proclaiming the truth of your word and the message of the cross, may we never, ever back down. We pray these things through the power of Jesus' name. Amen. That concludes our service, but I think we've got an announcement from Tyler.
Just a few quick reminders. Please dispose of your communion cups on the way out the door, please. Also, college students, this is the week to begin signing up for projects for Bisons for Christ. If you go to Pipeline and you search Bisons for Christ, I believe, you can assemble a group of friends and get going on a project. Also, a week from today, we're going to have a singing to kick off the week of Bisons for Christ. We're hoping to have more than we did the last time, but if you've ever been a part of one of these, you know it's a really special night of worship, so please come out for that. Have a great week. You all are dismissed.